NASA's new rocket has finally launched, the SLS for the Space Launch System. It's a massive rocket designed to get people back to the moon and one day even to Mars. So how does it work? And is it any better than the Space Shuttle or the Saturn V? NASA's moon program Artemis is a complex web of missions, rockets, space stations, lunar landers, and moon bases. Today, we're going to focus on only one part, the Space Launch System, NASA's shiny new super rocket. The SLS actually comes in several versions, and the one that just launched is called Block 1. It's one of the smallest configurations of the SLS, but smallest is relative here because Block 1 stands at 322 feet tall, nearly twice as tall as the Space Shuttle, with about four times the power at launch. If it looks a bit familiar, that's because NASA took the very best design features from the Saturn V rocket and the Space Shuttle and combined them. You can really think of the SLS in four parts: the two solid rocket boosters, the core stage, and the Orion upper stage at the top. Let's walk through the launch to understand how these systems work together. At liftoff, the two rocket boosters and the core stage all ignite on launch pad 39B. You may remember the rocket boosters from the Space Shuttle. These boosters use a solid rocket fuel instead of a liquid fuel. The advantage is that they are simple and powerful, providing about 7 million pounds of thrust. The disadvantage is that once they are ignited, they cannot be turned off. These boosters on SLS are bigger than the ones on the Space Shuttle, with 5 segments instead of 4, giving them 25% more fuel. By themselves, they could lift the entire rocket off the pad, but they actually have some help from the core stage. The core stage is the orange segment in the center of the rocket. It burns cryogenic liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen in 4 RS-25 engines from the Space Shuttle. One of the coolest parts about these engines is that they are super clean environmentally. Their only byproduct is water vapor. The core stage also looks like the external tank from the Space Shuttle, and actually that's pretty much what it is. It's just much larger. It's even the same diameter and is sprayed with the same iconic orange foam that is so recognizable from the Space Shuttle design. After launch, the rocket boosters and the core stage together produce nearly 9 million pounds of thrust, exerting more power than any rocket ever, including Saturn V. After 2 minutes, the solid rocket boosters have burned all of their fuel. At this point, they become dead weight, so NASA has designed the boosters to separate from SLS and fall back to Earth, while the core stage continues its climb into space. Unlike with the Space Shuttle, these rocket boosters will not be reused in future missions. So let's talk about this bit at the top of Orion, the Launch Abort System, or LAS. If there's an emergency, such as an explosion, the LAS activates automatically within milliseconds to pull the spacecraft and passengers away from the rocket. It is the best and most powerful launch abort system ever built, able to pull away from an explosion with 400,000 pounds of thrust, outrunning the rest of the SLS rocket. If that were to happen, it would automatically plot a safe landing course for the crew inside. The launch abort system pulls away from the rocket because it's no longer needed. 8 minutes after launch, the core stage has also burned all of its fuel, and our rocket is soaring at about 100 miles above Earth. Then the Orion upper stage pulls away from the core stage, leaving the core to fall back to Earth and burn up on re-entry. The Orion stage is now parked in a low Earth orbit, circling the Earth at 17,500 miles per hour. With the Block 1 configuration of SLS, it can deliver an astounding 209,000 pounds to orbit in a single launch. But we are not done yet. Now it's time for the translunar injection, or TLI. This is when the rocket reignites its engine at exactly the right time to leave the Earth orbit and head for the moon. If you mistime this maneuver, you will either crash right into the moon, or worse, you will fly off into the black void of space. You've got to get the TLI exactly right so that your spacecraft will get captured by the moon's gravity and you can enter into a lunar orbit. The upper stage with Orion has several mini stages built in. This large bottom part is called the Interim Cryogenic Propulsion Stage, or the ICPS for short. It carries a single RL-10 engine for this special maneuver, and it accelerates the whole stage to 24,500 miles per hour, a velocity fast enough to overcome the pull of Earth's gravity and propel Orion to the moon. Once the burn is complete, the ICPS separates from Orion. Now all we're left with is Orion and its European Service Module, or ESM. The ESM provides the primary power and propulsion for Orion during each mission. At this stage in our journey, the ESM deploys its solar panels to provide additional power. So, in comparison to the Apollo Service Module, the ESM generates twice as much electricity, weighs half as much, and is designed to support crews for 3 weeks in space, rather than the 2 weeks of the Apollo Service Module. A few days later, Orion arrives at the moon and performs the lunar orbit insertion burn, allowing itself to be captured by the moon's gravity so that it goes into an elliptical orbit. In future missions, this is when the cargo or crew would dock with the Lunar Gateway station to prepare to land on the moon. When Orion is ready to return to Earth, it will perform a return powered flyby, or RPF, which uses the moon's gravity to help slingshot Orion back to Earth. As Orion approaches Earth, the crew module separates from the ESM. The ESM will be destroyed in the atmosphere, but the crew module will orient itself so that the re-entry shield will take the compressive heat of falling to Earth at 25,000 miles per hour, protecting the cargo and astronauts inside from the 5,000 degrees Fahrenheit outside. Finally, the crew module splashes down in the Pacific Ocean, where it will be picked up by the US Navy. We started our journey with this, the full SLS stack, and we have ended up with this, the Orion Crew Module. So that's how SLS works. It has taken over a decade, billions of dollars, and 80,000 engineers to get SLS up and running. The result is the most powerful rocket ever built, a rocket designed to take humans back to the moon and maybe even to Mars. But in this new era of private space companies like SpaceX, why did NASA build SLS instead of using a cheaper option? And why are they reusing so many parts from the space shuttle? Well, I'm gonna dig into those questions in my other SLS video on my channel. There's a link in my description. Regardless of the politics and the expense, there's no doubt that as of now, the SLS is the most powerful rocket that has ever launched.
Let's get some contact with the test. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.